Dust. Dust is an unavoidable byproduct in woodworking that probably wraps almost every workshop in a brownish gray veil. Dust does not only affect the surfaces on which it settles, it's also a health risk. Inhaling hardwood dust in particular increases your risk of getting cancer and reduces your lung function in the long run, in addition to other diseases that can be triggered, like asthma and dermatitis. So there are good reasons why you should try to keep wood dust away from you. Already in my first video I have planned a dust collector for my workshop. It should be placed in a small room at the back of my workshop and lead through a pipe system to the machines. I already bought a suitable dust collector last year for my jointer. The jointer is difficult to use without extraction because a lot of chips are produced. So why didn't I already build a pipe system? Well, originally my plan was to motorize the whole thing. Such a tube system needs a blast gate so that it's always only opened at one point, namely the currently operated machine. If it was opened everywhere, the suction performance would decrease rapidly, even to the point of ineffectiveness. I therefore wanted to have a switch behind each machine that would open the right blast gate when the machine is turned on. That wouldn't be necessary at all, but I just thought it was pretty cool and thought it would be an exciting project. I bought myself an Arduino a long time ago to do this, and did some research to write a simple code to control the servo motors. They would then open the blast gates. But if I already do such an effort, it would be easy to take the last step and fully automate the dust collection. This means that when a machine is turned on, the current flow is registered, the dust collector is switched on and the proper blast gate opened. And when the machine is switched off, it is closed again. Such systems are standard in larger workshops and industrial factories, and many workshop vacuum cleaners are also equipped with this function. But the whole thing would be involved in the making of the long planned socket strip, which is still delayed due to some complications. So I decided against the motorization and built it the old-fashioned way, which means manually controlled. As tubes, I used the standard drain pipes you get in every DIY store. They are actually intended for wastewater, but because of this they are also suitable for dust extraction. Their smooth and rigid surface minimalizes friction and thus turbulences inside, which results in a better airflow. And because they have to be waterproof, they are also almost airtight. The pipes should come out of the wall in the corner and be distributed under the ceiling in the workshop and run to the machines. I also wanted to have a small floor extraction where I can sweep dirt into. The extraction unit should be located in a small room just as planned. So when the door is closed, you don't notice as much of the noise of the extraction unit. And in addition to the filter of the unit, you have another separating layer between your lungs and the dust. The first step is to break through the wall. The wall is just 12 centimeters thick, so I drilled some holes with a masonry drill and knocked the stone away with a hammer and chisel. The hose of my extraction unit measures 100 mm inside diameter, the drain pipes 105. In order to be able to connect them together anyway, I cut the pipe open and narrow it down to a cone. Thank you. The extraction unit can then be parked in the right place and the hose connected. I was unsure whether this system would have enough power to transport chips over a longer distance, especially the 2 meters vertically against gravity made me worry. That's why I quickly put a short distance together to test the whole thing. The chips were easily sucked in, I don't have to worry about the performance. Now I wanted to cover the wall opening with an aluminum panel. I thought it would be quite quick to make and good looking, easier and nicer than plastering them in. I had no idea that I was completely wrong. The panel should also lead a parallel blank pipe through the wall, so I can put cables and pneumatic hoses through the wall. My air compressor should also disappear in the room. So I went to the DIY store and got myself a small plate of aluminum and some angles. The wall opening is covered on both sides, so I need 2 smaller pieces. The angles shall be mitered and give the panel a nice edge. I wanted to make the connection of the pipes to the panel with a 3D printed ring. It should cover the transition and hold the blank pipe in place. For the openings in the aluminum, I first drilled a hole with a step drill and then cut out a cycle with a jigsaw. And I can tell you this works horribly poor. The aluminum is very easily torn along and wobbles, gets scratched and bent. As long as it is not clamped all around, this method is horribly bad. And the surrounding clamping was not really possible with such a small piece. It would have always been in the way of the jigsaw. With the second piece, I therefore prefer to drill a few more holes in order to get ahead faster with the jigsaw and not have to cut into curves, so the hole works a little bit better. Afterwards, everything was sanded with the bed grinder. And the parts fit just as planned. The angles then get holed at regular intervals, which I then transfer through the angle to the aluminum. Then they are fastened with 4mm blind rivets. Through the angles, the hole becomes more stable and doesn't wobble around anymore. Should tighten each other to the wall, therefore I want to pull a few long bolts through both panels and the wall, so I drilled some holes. Then I transfer the holes with a center punch to the second panel, so they lie exactly opposite each other. At first I thought of a threaded rod with nuts instead of bolts, but then the nut would have to be locked on one side while I tighten the nut on the other. But since I work alone and only ever reach it from one side, this was not possible. That's why I use lock bolts. They have a square on their head, which can practically counter itself in the sheet metal. The printer part for the blank pipe should be connected by a few small screws, so I drill a few holes into the pipe. But I didn't think about how to attach these screws later, because you can't reach them from the inside and therefore can't put a nut on them. Therefore, only one side will be fixed later. I had to enlarge the wall opening still a little bit so that the screws have space. And what I also haven't thought about is, how do I get the screws through both holes? I can't guide them, I can't reach behind the panel, there isn't enough room. You might be able to do something like that with two people, but you don't stand a chance on your own. My solution was perhaps a bit unconventional. I wrapped dental floss around the screws and was able to fiddle the floss through the holes and then pull the screws through. I couldn't believe this stupid idea actually worked. I should perhaps mention that at that time I had already spent 3 evenings only with the panels and my nerves were a little strained. I then fastened the printed parts with some silicone. The first step is now finished. Now the actual pipe system and the blast gates are still missing. More on that in part 2.